Dear students, the topic we are going to discuss today is transporting plants. To each and every part of the plant body. Similarly, how the plant lost water. Again, certain temperate plants losing the water in liquid form, commonly called guttation. We will see one by one. The first one is ascent of sap, which can be broadly defined as the upward movement of water from tree base to tree top is called by the term ascent of sap. Upward conduction of water from the roots to different part of the plant body is called by the term ascent of sap. There are various theories are proposed to explain the mode of transportation, which can be broadly included under three major heads. One is vital theories, second is root pressure theory, and third is the physical theories. So the concept behind each theory is different. First we will see what is meant by the vital theory. According to vital theory, upward movement of water takes place due to the activity of living cells of the plant bordering the xylem. So the activities of xylem surrounding living tissue facilitate the event called ascent of sap. The first in vital theory is relay pump theory, proposed by the man Golowski in 1884. According to him, the rhythmic changes in osmotic pressure of living cells in xylem parenchyma are responsible for upward movement of water. So the point is very simple. Xylem parenchyma surrounding the xylem, which are rhythmically changing their osmotic pressure, which leads to ascent of sap. The negative point of the theory is that ascent of sap continues in the system in which even though the living cells are killed by poison. So that cleanly indicates that ascent of sap takes place not by the help of the parenchyma surrounding the xylem. The second theory is pulsation theory, proposed by the Indian scientist Sir J.C. Bose during 1923. According to him, ascent of sap takes place due to pulsatory mechanism of living cortical cells present nearer to the vessels and tracheids in the xylem. That is, the innermost cortical parenchyma cells, which can rhythmically alternatively contract and relax like the heart, by which the water can be pumped upwards. So that was the concept of the man J.C. Bose. By means of electric probe needle, he demonstrated the pulsatory mechanism of living cells. So it was also proven by him by using the electric probe. The theory was rejected because he could not repeat the experiments, and there was no correlation between pulsatory activity and ascent of sap. So because of the reason, the theory was rejected. Then the third component coming under the category root pressure theory, proposed by the man Stocking in 1956. He chosen a healthy potted plant. The aerial portion was detopped by a riser. The free end was connected with a rubber tube, which in turn with a mercury manometer. After few hours, he noticed that the level of the mercury in the mercury manometer is rising up. This was the experiment demonstrated by the man stalking. So he explained ascendant sap, rising of water as a consequence of absorbed water in the tracheary elements, or hydrostatic pressure developed by the tracheary elements leads to ascent of sap. But the theory was discarded because of the following points. One is, ascent of sap is observed in the plants in which even the roots are removed. Second point is that the magnitude of ascent of sap by root pressure was comparatively less. Third is, in gymnosperm, the root pressure is rarely observed. We know that the tallest plant, Sequoia dendron, have the height of 120 meters, where ascent of sap is taking place even in the absence of root pressure. So these points are negative to the theory root pressure proposed by Stalking. The third category is physical theories. The idea behind the theory is that ascent of sap is taking place as a consequence of physical force, in which the first theory is imbibition theory, proposed by the man Sack. According to this theory, the ascent of sap occurs due to imbibitional activity of the cell wall of the xylem elements. So the wall of the xylem imbibe the water, as a consequence of that, it creating imbibition pressure by which water is pumping up. Again, this theory is also discarded, as it has been experimentally found that water rises up through the lumen of the xylem, not through the wall of the xylem. Then the second theory in physical category is transpiration pull and cohesion theory, are also called by the term cohesion tension theory. The theory was originally proposed by Dixon and Jolly, later supported by a group of plant physiologists such as Renner, Curtis, Clark, Benner, Goldstone, Kramer. Here, there are two diagrams are given, are experiments which demonstrate the mechanism of ascent of sap by transpiration pull theory. In the first case, a porous port was connected with a water column. The free end was connected with an empty tube, which was inserted into a beaker containing mercury. The hole was clamped in a stand, placed in open sunlight. As a consequence of evaporation, the porous pot loses water, which is creating a pulling force by which water is drawn from the column seen beneath. When the level of water in the column decreases, it applies the force in the empty capillary tube, which is immersed in a beaker containing mercury. Because of the tremendous pulling force due to evaporation, the mercury gradually rising up. This can be also demonstrated by taking a wide glass tube open at either end. Both ends are closed by using one hole rubber cocks. Through the upper end, insert a fresh, healthy plant twig and was made airtight by applying Vaseline. The lower end was connected with an empty glass capillary tube that was also made airtight by applying Vaseline. The free end of the capillary tube is immersed in a beaker containing mercury. The whole apparatus was clamped, placed in open sunlight. Just like the previous case, the healthy plant wick loses water as a consequence of transpiration, creating a pulling force by which the water from the wide glass tube was absorbed or transported up. Because of the pulling force, conducted into the empty glass capillary tube, which in turn suck the density mercury into the capillary tube. Both experiments prove that as a consequence of evaporation or transpiration, a pulling force was created by which the water is rising up in the plant, called by the term ascent of sap. So, this is the experiment proving the view of the man Dixon and Jolly. The experiment shown previously can be compared with the living plants. The living plant absorbing water from the soil, which is pumping up as a consequence of transpiration occurring in the aerial leafy shoots. So, here you can see the diagrammatic representation of the events. As a consequence of transpiration, a pulling force was developed by which the water is raised from the lower region via the xylem tube upwardly, what we are calling by the term ascent of sap. So, whenever the rate of transpiration is high, which indirectly leads to high ascent of sap. So, the shoot is acting as a master and root is acting as a slave, simply obeying the order given by the aerial transpiring shoots. So, the same thing was demonstrated here. The transpiration leading to the pulling force by which the water is rising up via the xylem tubes. So, that was the experimental evidence given by Dixon and Jolly. Water is pulled upward by negative pressure in the xylem. Water vapor in the airspace of a leaf tissue diffuses down its water potential gradient and exits the leaf via stomata. Transpiration produces the negative pressure, commonly called tensile pressure, in the leaf, which exerts a pulling force on water in the xylem, pulling water into the leaf. So, this is what we calling by the term transpiration pull. This theory is based upon three major components or three major concepts. One is a strong cohesive force existing between the water molecules. The word cohesive force means the mutual attraction between similar molecule. Here, the similar molecules are water. So, they are mutually attracted by this cohesive force. Second one is that adhesive force means attraction between dissimilar molecules. Here, the water molecule are attracted by the wall of the xylem and they are mutually attracted, called by the term adhesive force. And third one is, as we said earlier, as a consequence of transpiration, the plant creating a pulling force. So, the transpiration pull. So, all these are again supported by another very important factor called hydrogen bonds. Hydrogen bond is normally defined as whenever hydrogen atom comes between two electronegative atoms, it creating a bond, and this bond is commonly called by the term hydrogen bond. Usually, the hydrogen bond is weaker But when enormous hydrogen bonds are present, it becomes mutually stronger. So these are the components adding strength to the event called cohesion tension theory or transpiration pull theory. So here I have shown the hydrogen bond is a weak bond. When they are present in enormous numbers, as in the case of water, it becomes mutually very strong. The magnitude of this force is as high as 350 atmospheric pressure. So along with this hydrogen bond, cohesive force and the adhesive force adding strength to the event called ascent of sap. When transpiration takes place from the mesophyll cells of the leaves, it results in diffusion pressure deficit inside them. The mesophyll cells in turn absorb water from the nearby xylem elements. Loss of water from xylem elements results a similar diffusion pressure deficit in them, and ultimately a tension is created. This tension acts as a pulling force, what we referred by the term transpiration pull. As a result of this pull, the tension transmitted downward up to the roots through the stem, and upward movement of water takes place, which is analog to pulling of bucket of water from a well. So that is why I said that whenever the rate of transpiration is high, the rate of ascent of sap is equally high. So they are mutually interrelated, supported by the cohesive, adhesive and the hydrogen bonds. In spite of some objections, this theory is widely accepted because of the following facts. One is, there is a strong correlation between the rate of transpiration and ascent of sap, because absorption can be compared with transpiration by a water balance experiment. Second is, in a branch cut from a rapidly transpiring plant, water snaps away from the roots. So that can be easily shown. Whenever we are cutting a twig, we can see that sap is coming out. And third is, with the help of dipen graph by McDougall, observed the tree trunks show diurnal contraction. So all these are supporting the theory called transpiration pull theory. Limitations. What are the negative points of the theory? As you know that the plants are naturally growing in the environment, it is subjected to diurnal variation of temperature. Because of the variation of temperature affecting the xylem vessels or the tubes, creating cavitation or formation of air bubble, which can block the continuity of water column, which indirectly the even ascent of sap. We call the entire process by a term called cavitation. So cavitation can create or block the ascent of sap. That is the concept. It also states that tracheids are more efficient than vessels in conduction of water, because in gymnosperm, the plants containing tracheids rather than vessels, and they are efficient conducting channels. And these are the two limitations or demerits raised against the theory proposed by the man Dixon and Jolly. And the second component we are going to deal today is transpiration. So already we have seen the term transpiration coupled with ascent of sap. Transpiration is broadly defined as the loss of water in vapor form from the living tissue of the aerial part of the plant body is called transpiration. So the point is very simple, plant lost water in vapor form. So here I have shown the phenomena. So that play a very major role in the event to maintain the hydrological cycle in the nature, because the plant is losing water by transpiration, also the soil is losing water by evaporation. So the water in the atmosphere is precipitated as rain coming back to the earth. So transpiration play a major role in maintaining the water status in the atmosphere. Of all the water plant absorbed, over 95 to 99% is transpired out as vapor. Transpiration is broadly classified into three major types. One is cuticular, second is lenticular, third is stomatal. So the classification is based upon the region or the organ involved, either the cuticle or the lenticel or the stomata. So here I will give a question, from where water is transpired? Aerial part of the whole young plant or even the mature plants. Lenticels, lenticular transpiration, comprising very minimum 0.1%. Cutin, cuticular transpiration, ranging from 3 to 10%. The major share was given by stomata, so called by the term stomatal transpiration. We will see one by one, stomatal transpiration. So stomatal transpiration is occurring through the stoma. Stoma are located on the epidermal layer of the plant body, mostly in leaves. So this opening is regulated by two modified cells occurring on either side of the pore, called by the term guard cell. You can see the guard cell here. So if the water is going via the stomata, regulated by the guard cell, we normally putting a word called stomatal transpiration. Similarly, the epidermis is ensheathed by a thin or a thick cuticle. Cuticle is chemically made up of a fatty polymer, namely cutin. Usually the cutin is impervious or impermeable to water. But in some plants, the cuticle is very faint or thin, or the cuticle is discontinuous. So through the unthickened cuticle or unthickened area, the water can be transpired out. So we are putting a word called cuticular transpiration. The third one is lenticular transpiration. It is commonly come across in woody plants as well as in fruits. Lenticels are micropores occurring on the bark or the cork or on the periderm of the woody plants, or it is occurring on the pericarp of the fruits. So if the water is moving via the permanently opened lenticel or the pore, we commonly called lenticular transpiration. Usually just beneath the lenticel, it bearing a mass of thin walled parenchyma tissue, called by the term complementary tissue or complementary parenchyma. So which is one way or other regulating the lenticular transpiration. So the major share, as I said earlier, it is by the stomatal transpiration. So water moving via the stomata. So we are going to see in detail how the plant transpires water through stomata. So here I have shown the mode of transpiration of water through stomata. So here you can see, when we take the cross section of the leaf, usually the leaf containing an upper epidermis as well as a lower epidermis. Stomata may occur in the upper epidermis, then we call the condition by the term epistomatic nature. In some plants, stomata occurring only on the lower epidermis, called by the term hypostomatic nature. In addition to this, certain plants containing stomata both on the upper as well as on the lower, known by the term amphistomatic nature. So variable depends upon the plants or at the habitats. So here the plant losing water through the stomata, you can see here, so through which the water is going out as vapor form. So what we are generally putting a word, stomatal transpiration, stomal transpiration. So here I have shown the opened stomata here and as well as the closed stomata. So that's a unique property of the stomata. Stomata acting as a turgor operated valve. So the word clearly indicates that whenever the stomata, or I can put the way, the guard cells are turgid, the stomata opens. So the turgidity of the guard cell leading to the opening of stomata get opens. Meanwhile, when the guard cell becomes flaccid or when it becomes relaxed, the stomatal pore remain closed. So the guard cell thus regulating the opening and closing of stomata. Parallelly, the guard cells are enriched by a mass of cells, you can see the peripherally here. These cells are usually called by the term subsidiary cells. So that also play a role in regulating stomatal transpiration. So you can see here the opening and closing of stomata. Usually the stomata open during the daytime. So here the diagram representing the opened stomata at day. Here is the opposite condition. Stomata completely closed during night time or during the evening periods. So here I have shown a photograph of electron micrograph of the stoma. You can see the pore, actually the stomatal pore, and these are the guard cells. Okay. So again, another interesting thing is that the stomatal pore is also acting as a channel for the entry of gases, especially the carbon dioxide. So the point is, the stoma acting as a channel for the entry of carbon dioxide, which leads to photosynthesis. So entry of carbon dioxide through the stoma occurs in all living plants. So the function of stomata, these openings naturally allow water to evaporate out. What would be the plant close stoma with the guard cells? Prevent excess water loss through transpiration, thereby conserving the water. So what is the point of having stomata? Allows gas exchange for photosynthesis. So as already I said that, it's not only regulating transpiration, but also regulating directly or indirectly the even photosynthesis through the exit or entry of the compound carbon dioxide. So again, I am repeating the very same point, the opened stomata and closed stomata and the structure of the stomata. Usually, the guard cell containing a number of green colored plastids not come across in the subsidiary cells. So they are called by the term chloroplasts. So the chloroplasts are abundant in the guard cells. So they are actively involved in photosynthesis. Cells that open and close the stoma. Stomata opening in leaf's surface when open, allowing the exchange of gases, parallelly the transpiration. So these are the photograph of electron micrograph of leaf showing the entry of carbon dioxide and exit of water. So the closed stomata and the open stomata. So again, EM photograph of the leaf surface showing a number of stomata. Here, the diagram representing the structure of the guard cell, especially the cellulose fibril distribution in the guard cell. That is, the guard cells are unevenly thickened. That's very unique, which make the guard cell expand during the turgidity and closed when they are relaxed. So the cell wall chemistry play a major role in the opening and closing of guard cells. So here you can see the guard cell wall, that cell wall, have got radially arranged cellulose microfibrils. You can see here. And again in monocots, the guard cell have got another shape, dumbbell shaped in nature. There also you can see the distribution of the cellulose microfibrils. So the point here is that if we put the guard cell like this one, usually the cell wall thickening is here, the wall is thinner, flexible and absolutely permeable. Whereas if you go here the wall is highly thicker like this one. So here the wall is absolutely thicker, not flexible and not as permeable as the outer side. This differential cell wall chemistry will make the guard cell to respond unevenly during turgidity and flaccidity. So the point is very important. The wall chemistry is entirely peculiar, entirely unique. The wall away from the pore is thinner, flexible, permeable. The wall towards the pore is thicker, not flexible and slightly impermeable. So whenever the guard cell absorbing the water, it expanding unevenly. So the point is the microfibrils are distributed unevenly in the cell wall of the guard cell. So which regulating the even opening and closing. So here I have said the same point, thickness of the cell wall varies on the ventral and dorsal part of the guard cell, contain chloroplasts and can perform photosynthesis, structurally isolated from epidermal cells and lack plasma desmata, thus help to build up the water gradients. Little volume, little amount of water absorption or loss control the stomatal aperture. So these are the peculiarities of the guard cell which play a major role in regulating transpiration. There are number of theories are proposed which explaining how the guard cell expand or relax. Out of the major many theories, there are two major theories are accepted universally. One is the change of sugar to starch or the influx or efflux of potassium. These are the two components regulating the opening and closing of stomata. So here I have narrated the event called how the guard cell influx potassium or efflux potassium. The point here is that if I put the guard cell figure like this one, so this is the guard cell. I said earlier that it is completely ensheathed by the subsidiary cells. So these are the subsidiary cells. And this is the guard cell. Here the subsidiary cells are acting as storehouse of the component potassium. Also they containing chloride ions. So they are acting as storehouse of potassium and chloride ions. The guard cell producing malic acid via the metabolic pathway, malic acid. This ionizes into malate anion and H plus cations. So that's the first step. So ionization of malic acid leading to the formation of malate anion and H plus cation. Second point is that the H plus cation is exchanged with the potassium cation occurring in the subsidiary cells. That is ionic exchange. In this exchange, they consume the energy currency of the cell called ATP. So that is ionic exchange utilize the energy source called ATP. So now the guard cell containing plenty of potassium ions. Meanwhile, the subsidiary cells containing H plus ions. In order to balance the charge difference caused by the potassium ions, the chloride ion is moving passively into the guard cells. So now the guard cell contain potassium chloride ions. So this increase the osmotic concentration, which leads to absorption of water from the neighboring mesophyll cells, make the guard cell turgid, which leads to uneven expanding, creating the pore through which the water in the mesophyll tissue moving via the pore as diffusion into the outer atmosphere. During the night time or during the dark, the reversible process occurs. During the reversible process, this was regulated by an important growth hormone. You will study the growth hormone later in physiology. ABA, expanded as abscisic acids, a growth regulator or a growth hormone. This hormone is preventing not only the ionization of malic acid, but also promoting the reversible exchange. That is, the H plus is moving back into the guard cell and K plus is moving back into the subsidiary cells. So this change reduces the osmotic concentration. Now the water in the guard cell moving back into the mesophyll cells. The wall of the guard cell relax, leading to closing or closing of the stomatal pore. So the daytime and nighttime, there are two separate events. Basically depends upon the influx of potassium leading to opening, efflux of potassium leading to closing. Similarly, the other theory, sugar starch hypothesis, states that whenever the guard cell containing plenty of sugar, soluble sugar, promote opening. Parallelly, in the dark, the guard cell containing rich amount of insoluble sugar, namely starch, which promote closing of stomata. So the concept is either influx of potassium or the influx of sugar, soluble sugar. In the closing, efflux of potassium or the conversion of sugar into starch. Okay, so that was the basic reason for making the guard cell either turgid or flaccid. So here you can see the exchange phenomena, malic acid ionizing and exchange is occurring. And this exchange is using the component ATP. So the same thing is repeated here. The wall of the guard cell expanding unevenly as and when potassium and chloride enter into the cell. Okay. So leading to turgidity, it is expanding out. Then during the closing time, the potassium and chloride moving away. You can see here. Potassium and chloride is moving away. So it relaxed, it remained closed. So that was a universally accepted theory explaining the opening closing of stomata. And again, we can demonstrate the same. If you're putting the leaf in a particular concentration of potassium, this opens. So potassium definitely promoting opening of stomata. That can be also experimentally proved. The next thing is that we want to know what are the factors which regulate stomatal opening. The factors which regulate stomatal opening can be categorized into two major heads. One is the external factors acting from the environment into the plants. Second is the internal factors which are present within the plants. For example, the stomatal number, commonly we are putting a word stomatal index. That means number of stomata per unit area of the leaf surface. The higher the stomatal index, the more the rate of transpiration. So stomatal number is regulating the transpiration. Second is that in some xerophytic plants, the leaves are completely absent. and stem is modified into leaf-like organ, called differently by the people as willow-clad or cladode. So there in such cases, since there is no leaves, there is no stomata. Again, the rate of transpiration can be regulated. In certain xerophytic plants, like in casuarina or neem leaf, if you are taking the stomata, the stomata is occurring in deep pits like this one, completely ensheathed by a number of hairs called epidermal hairs. So these are commonly called epidermal hairs. And the stomata occurring in a pits, we call the stomata by the term called sunken stomata. So, stomatal number, sunken stomata, leaf modification are the internal factors. Parallelly, a number of external factors from the environment affecting stomatal opening. So, the major among them are, one is light, second is the temperature, third is the carbon dioxide concentration, fourth is the water content, fifth is the plant hormone level. So, we will see one by one. Light, stomata of most plant open in the daytime, close at night. So, there is an exception for this. So, there is a category of plants commonly called CAMP, crassulacean acid metabolism plants, where the stomata are nocturnal, that is, they are opening only at night. In the daytime, the stomata remain closed. So, except the crassulacean plants, all other plants, the stomata open in light and close at night. Stomata opening are sensitive to red light and blue light. That's another interesting point. So, if you are taking the photosynthesis, you are going to learn in the next class. Photosynthesis is activated by blue and red lights. Similarly, the stomatal transpiration is also regulated by the lights. Blue light is more effective than the red lights. So, that is again very unique. So, blue light enhances the stomatal transpiration, since it stimulates the opening by a blue light receptor, namely zeaxanthin. So, recently we are putting another term called cryptochrome. That is a pigment occurring in the plant body activated by the blue light, which will enhance the transpiration. So, anyway, light is playing a major role in regulating stomatal transpiration. So, you can see here, the blue light is, you can see the enhanced rate of photosynthesis comparing the red lights. Red light was very minimum comparing the blue lights. Temperature. So, light is indirectly or directly linked with the temperature. Stomatal aperture increases with the temperature within 20 to 30 degrees centigrade, the optimal. So, as and when the temperature increases, the rate of transpiration was parallelly increasing. That means, transpiration at par with temperature. Third one, CO2 concentration. Low CO2 concentration promotes stomatal opening, while high CO2 concentration inhibits stomatal opening through acidification of the guard cell, thus inhibiting the plasma membrane hyperpolarization. That is a very interesting point. So, if you are taking the carbon dioxide, if the level was high, it simply joined with the water molecule and they forming a compound, namely carbonic acid, a weak acid, which immediately ionizes into hydrogen plus and bicarbonate ions. So, this is leading to what I said earlier, namely acidification. Okay, but high CO2 concentration inhibiting the stomatal opening, that is leading to closure of stomata, because the stomatal pore permitting the entry of CO2 molecule, which react with the water molecule forming the carbonic acid, immediately ionizing into bicarbonate and H+ ion. So, the high pH promoting the closing of stomata. Meanwhile, during the daytime, there is no chance of the formation of these acids. So, the pH level was decreasing, leading to open. The fourth one is water containing. Stomata open when the leaf contain, enough water, that is when the leaf is turgid. Whenever there is a shortage of water, the stomata normally closes. It's an adaptation. It's an adaptation shown by the plant. Whenever there is a scarcity of water, it immediately closes. Plant hormones. There are two important hormones. Cytokinin promoting opening. That is, indirectly it is promoting opening in the sense that it causes expansion of cells. So, high cytokinin content can lead to expansion of cells, which indirectly leads to stomatal opening. Meanwhile, abscisic acid, as I said earlier, this inhibit stomatal opening because it prevent the ionization of malic acids. Secondly, it remove all the potassium back into the subsidiary cells. By this manner, it prevent the transpiration. So, we call normally ABA by the term antitranspirants. So, here I have again put two major factors which regulating the transpiration. Difference in water vapor gradients. Second is diffusional resistance, because the water has to diffuse from the mesophyll into the outer atmosphere. So, these are the two other component physical parameters again regulating the transpiration. So, here I have shown the vapor pressure gradient. The driving force of transpiration is the vapor pressure gradient. This is the difference in vapor pressure between the internal space in the leaf, that means the mesophyll tissue, and the atmosphere around the leaf. So, this gradient can again promoting the event called stomatal transpiration. Diffusional resistance comprises stomatal resistance and the boundary layer resistance, means the internal components which can resist the diffusional rate. The last component in transporting plant is guttation. If you are observing certain plants like colocasia or tomato or nasturtium, geranium, you can see in the early morning the tip of the leaf containing water droplets. We call the phenomena by the term guttation. So, guttation means loss of water in liquid form from uninjured margin of the leaf, mostly along the tip, is called by the term guttation. You can see here, you can see the guttated water. It is moving along the margin or along the tip of the leaf. Guttation is usually occurring through a permanently opened pore occurring in the tip of the leaf, called by the term hydatode or water stomata. So, not like the stomata of the stomatal transpiration. Here, the pore is permanently open, a small pore which remains permanently opened, and this pore is followed by a loose mass of tissue on the lower region called by the term epitherm. They are living parenchyma cells, somewhat similar to the complementary tissue of lenticels. So, epitherm is occurring just beneath the water stomata. Guttation is always occur through the hydatode, marginally or directly or indirectly regulated by the epitherm. So, what are the difference between the two events? So, I have given the two table. One is transpiration and the other one shown in red, guttation. Transpiration, loss of water in gaseous form. Here, water is lost in liquid. Transpired water is absolutely pure. It is not at all contaminated with any components. Pure water is transpired as vapor. Guttated water is impure in the sense that it containing a number of dissolved salts, sugar, That means it containing both organic and inorganic elements. And third is transpirations occurring through cuticle, lenticel or stomata, where guttation is occurring only through gahydrothole or the water stomata. And the fifth point is that transpiration is a common universal phenomena in all plants. Guttation is occurring only in certain plants growing in temperate region of the world. The last point is that transpiration is regulated by a number of parameters both internally and externally. Guttation is regulated probably by the root pressure, because we know that guttation is occurring during early morning where rate of transpiration is low. So the water content in the tracheary elements of the root will be higher, which is creating the positive hydrostatic pressure called by the term root pressure. So which may be the reason facilitating the event called guttation. So again, the last component is that usually transpiration is called by the people as a necessary evil phenomena or an unavoidable evil. Why it was so? Because transpiration has got both merits and demerits. What are the merits? What are the advantages? It creates a transpiration pool which facilitates transport of water to any part of the plant body. So we have seen earlier it facilitating the ascent of sap. Second is it supplies water for photosynthesis, because water is pumped to any part of the cells. Transport of minerals from soil to all part of the plant body. It cools the surface of the leaves due to evaporation of water. Keeps the cells turgid, hence maintains the shape. So we have got some merits like transportation of water and minerals have got a cooling effect in the plant body. Meanwhile, it is harmful or have got demerits. As water is lost from the plant body, due to this, the plant faces an acute water shortage, scarcity for water. The plants are variously modified, extra burden to the plant. The plant is modifying its parts. As I said earlier, the leaves are completely reduced to spine or into scale leaf. Stem became photosynthetic. So it is an extra burden for the plant, have got some modifications. Similarly, the deciduous trees shed their leaves just to minimize the transpiration. You can notice in the summer season, the plants lose their leaves just to an adaptation to minimize transpiration. So the modification in the plant, deciduous nature of the plant, death of the plant due to scarcity of water are the demerits. So one side we got the merit and the other side we got the demerits. So that's why it is aptly designated as it is an unavoidable evil or it is a necessary evil process. Now we can move into the question sessions. Question number 1. Which of the following will cause the stomata to close? Just we have learnt. What are the major components leading to closure of stomata? The options are A. Increase in carbon dioxide concentration. B. Darkness. C. Both A and B. D. Oxygen concentration. E. Minerals. The correct answer is both CO2 concentration and darkness. So both A and B. CO2 concentration inhibits stomatal opening through its acidification, just we said earlier. Stomata of most plant open in the daytime. So light or the darkness, CO2 affecting stomatal transpiration. So both A and B. Question number 2. Movement of carbon dioxide into the leaf through stomata during photosynthesis is by. One is imbibition. Option B, diffusion. C, osmosis. D, transpiration. E, respiration. Just we have gone through that. How the CO2 molecule move into the leaf? The answer is by simple phenomena called diffusion. Molecules are moving from high concentration to low concentration through the stomatal pore. So, the answer is diffusion. Number 3, the reason that a column of water in a tall tree does not sink because of its weight is a difficult level question. Option A, the formation of hydrogen bond within the xylem vessels. B, bubbles that are too large to be transported via the xylem. C, the tensile strength of column of water. D, the presence of high concentration of ions near the top of the tree. E, evaporation. The correct answer is the tensile strength of column of water. Transpiration produces negative pressure, that is tension in the leaf, which exerts a pulling force on water in the xylem, pulling water into the leaf. So, the answer is the tensile strength of column of water. Number 4. In most species, as potassium ion moves in or out of the guard cell to regulate stomatal opening, comma, there is movement of dash in the opposite direction. So, once potassium moving in or out of the cell, another ion is moving in the opposite direction, which is the element, which is the ion. Options are chloride, sodium, hydrogen ion, calcium, OH radicals, hydroxyl molecules. The answer is hydrogen ion. So, I said earlier, this exchange is occurring between potassium to hydrogen ion during influx as well as during efflux. So, the option is C, hydrogen ions. The fifth one, cobalt chloride is used for testing water produced in plants. So, it is a common experiment we are conducting in the lab. When water is present, what color change takes place in cobalt chlorides? Option, pink to blue, pink to green, blue to pink, red to blue, blue to colorless. Blue to pink. So, the question is, cobalt chloride is used for testing water produced in plants. When water is present, the cobalt chloride changes from blue to pink color. So, the answer is blue to pink, option C. Question number 6. Which of the following process cools the surface of leaves? A very simple question. Options are transpiration, guttation, diffusion, imbibition, ion exchange. Which physical process makes the leaves cooler? The answer is transpiration, because as and when the plant loses water, it producing a cooling effect. So, option is A. So, this is a difficult level of question. So, you have to compare the two columns. The first column comprises A, relay pump theory, B, root pressure theory, C, pulsation theory, D, transpiration pull theory. In the column 2, the scientists who proposed the theory. Stocking, Gorlovsky, Dixon and Jolly, J.C. Bose, Curtis. So you can compare the theory with the man behind the theory. The quotes are given here, A to E. The answer is option A. Relay pump theory was proposed by the man Gorlovsky, one of the vital theories. Road pressure theory by the man Stocking. Pulsation theory, the Indian born scientist J.C. Bose. Transpiration pool theory, the most accepted theory, Dixon and Jolly. So the option is eighth one, the substance acts as antitranspirant in plants naturally. So, we have seen two hormones. So, which hormone acting as antitranspirant? Option A, abscisic acids. Option B, auxin. C, gibberellic acids. D, ethylene. E, salicylic acids. Now, average level question. The answer is abscisic acids. ABA inhibits the exchange of H plus with K plus, and also ionization of malic acid will be inhibited. So, thereby the stomata closes. So, the option is A. Which of the following character is not applicable to stomata? So, we have seen the characters of stomata. Here, out of the choices, which is a character not seen in stoma or stomata? A, located on the surface of the leaves. B, regulated by a pair of guard cells. C, open during daytime. D, found in all plants. E, permanently open to pore. The answer is, the false statement is permanently open to pore, because stomata open during daytime because of turgidity and closes during night because of flaccidity. So, the correct answer is E. So, the option is E, permanently open to pore. It is not applicable to stomata. The water moves from mesophyll of the leaves to atmosphere by. So, initially we have seen a similar question, movement of carbon dioxide, imbibition, diffusion, osmosis, transpiration, respiration. A simple question. The answer is diffusion. Water content from the mesophyll diffuses out into the atmosphere. The option is B. The 11th one is, in woody plants, the water is lost from bark to bark. In woody plants, the water is lost from bark through. We have seen three types of transpiration. Sort of that, stomata, cuticle, stomata and cuticle, lenticel, lenticel and stomata. So, the answer is the option D, lenticel, aerating pore in bark of woody plants. So, the answer is D. Lenticels are aerating component of woody plants occurring in the bark or on the cork. Dixon and Jolly theory related to rise of water in plant is based on the following facts, experimental. Cogsiphos. adhesive force, hydrogen bond, transpiration pool, road pressure. So see the question. Dixon Jolly related to rise of water in plants is based on the following facts except. So which is the fact not applicable to here? The answer is road pressure, because road pressure is the pressure developed in the root system as a consequence of absorbed water, have no role to play with transpiration. So the answer is option E. Thank you very much. Okay. So the part 1 of transport in plants, where we have studied the major physical phenomena like imbibition, diffusion, osmosis, and also the different membrane system in plants, namely permeable, impermeable, semi-permeable, selectively permeable. Again, the two types of osmosis, namely endosmosis and exosmosis, coupled with the two major mechanisms of water absorption, namely active and passive mechanism. Today, we have seen the three other components in transporting plants, such as transportation of water from the root of the plant to the tip of the plant. It's called by the term ascent of sap, and the theories explaining the mechanism. Secondly, the loss of water in plant, either in vapor form called transpiration or liquid form called gettation, and the various theories explaining the transpiratory process. Similarly, the different type of transpiration, namely lenticular, cuticular, stomatal. Lastly, the gettation occur through the permanently opened pore hydatode. Hope that you followed the entire spectra of transport in plants. Thank you very much.